Hello everyone, and welcome to the St. Louis Art Museum's Art Speaks program. My name is Jessica Kennedy, and I'm the educator for adult learning at the museum. Before we begin, please familiarize yourself with the Q&A section located on your screen. Feel free to enter your questions at any time during the program, and we will choose a few to answer at the end. Also, there is live auto transcription available for this program. Please click the CC icon to activate or deactivate the subtitles. For today's talk, Art Speaks, the History of the Garnsey Murals, we are joined by three SLAM staff members: Assistant Paintings Conservator Courtney June Books, Museum Archivist Jenna Stout, and the Andrew W. Mellon Foundation Assistant Curator of American Art, Amy Torbert. Thanks so much for being here today, Courtney, Jenna, and Amy.
Thank you, Jessica, and thank you all out there for joining us. Today, we are going to introduce you to this set of paintings at SLAM, the ones on the screen here that we're looking at, which, at least to some of us, have tended to fade into the background over time. This summer, as you will hear lots more of, we are going to bring them back into their former prominence. So let me begin and kind of get us situated by briefly setting the scene. If we could have met in the museum today, we would be gathered in Gallery 203, whose location is outlined in red on the floor plan and in the photo. To get here, you might have entered the museum's main entrance and can't come into Sculpture Hall, and then immediately turned to the left. You would have walked past the coat check there on your right in gallery, 201 in the floor plan, and proceeded through the gallery of 18th century European art, gallery 202. Imagine then entering gallery 203, a small square space, and looking up. The ceiling and walls of this space are covered with mural paintings made in 1915 by the American artist Elmer Garnsey, hence their collective title, the Garnsey Murals. This space was the original location of the museum's art library, and these paintings were created to decorate its grand entrance. This summer, our fantastic team of conservators is going to undertake a complete treatment of these paintings. As a teaser for that ongoing project, we wanted to share the fascinating history of these murals with you, from their creation in 1915 until today, the present. Jenna Stout, the museum's archivist, will start us off with an introduction to the history of the Richardson Memorial Library and its many moves around the museum. I will then return to the virtual podium to share more about Elmer Garnsey and how his murals relate to others created at the same time across America. Finally, Courtney Books, the museum's assistant paintings conservator, will give us a preview of the work that she and her team will undertake this summer. So, Jenna, take it away. The floor is yours.
Thank you, Amy, for introducing the Garnsey murals, which once graced the entryway to the Richardson Memorial Library. Now let's take a trip back to the late 19th century and learn a bit more about the library's history. So the earliest notion of the library originated downtown at the St. Louis School and Museum of Fine Arts, which was affiliated with Washington University. In 1906, the museum moved into Forest Park, the Palace of Fine Arts building, and by 1909, it had become a separate institution called the City Art Museum, which is what we now know as the St. Louis Art Museum. So the museum's book collection went to Washington University, which left the City Art Museum without a proper art library. The City Art Museum's first director, Halsey Ives, he wished to reestablish an art library in the museum, but he knew it was going to be a costly endeavor. So fortunately, in 1911, Mary D. Richardson funded the first legacy gift ever given to the museum. It was a bequest valued at $60,000 for a suitable memorial of an artistic nature in memory of her husband, Joseph Clifford Richardson, who was a St. Louis businessman. So what was the gift used for? It was going to be a library, of course. The museum commissioned Cass Gilbert, who was the architect of the museum building, to design the library, its casework, and its furnishings. Three galleries on the main floor of the building were converted to use as a library. So the original numbered galleries were galleries 5, 6, and 7. And you can see those in the center gallery guide map listed there. So the Richardson Memorial Library officially opened on April 18, 1915 with 5,000 volumes, which included architectural books from the library of Russell Sturgis. Blanche Archambault was formerly the librarian of the St. Louis School of Fine Arts. She served as the City Art Museum's first librarian from 1910 to 1937. She's shown in the right-hand photograph standing with other staff members, including Mary Powell. Mary Powell was actually the first art librarian at the St. Louis Public Library Central Branch, which was another Cass Gilbert design building. And it was Archambault's retirement in 1937 to 1938 period that coincided with the next chapter of the library's history. So you may be asking yourself, why and when did the Richardson Memorial Library move from the main floor? Well, by 1938, the museum's permanent art collections had grown in size, and the three main floor galleries of the library were reabsorbed to be used as exhibition space. It then fell to Louis LeBoum, the board president and also an architect by training, to ensure that the library was lifted from its original location and transported to its new home in the basement. His design of the new library space, which can be seen in the left-hand image, incorporated Gilbert's casework and furnishings, but it left behind those Garnsey murals that adorned Gallery 5. Well, moving a library down one floor was not a simple task. Workers had to meticulously deconstruct the bookcases piece by piece from the original reading room. The ground floor library space, as shown here in the 1938 blueprint, was a converted corridor with a low ceiling, which provided some challenges in reusing the materials from the main floor. A local factory actually manufactured bookcase ends to fill in some of the gaps as needed. Then also based on the terms of the Richardson gift, the bust of J. Clifford Richardson was to be on permanent display in the reading room. Now, the pedestal of the bust, though, was a little too tall for the lower ceiling clearance of the basement area. A local stone company was called in to construct a new pedestal base of statuary buffed Indiana limestone to fit the new space. The end result was a library space that, although not identical, maintained the overall aesthetics of the Richardson Memorial Library. With declining health, librarian Blanche Archambault retired before the 1938 move. It was Odell Stewart, who was also the mother of Phyllis Schlafly. She was hired as the next librarian, a position that she would hold for the next 25 years. She was new to the art library field, so she embarked on an information gathering tour of over 20 art museum libraries in the Midwest and along the Eastern Seaboard. At the conclusion of the tour, Stewart advocated for the removal of the outdated architectural books from the library's holdings. She noted that no new architectural books had been acquired since 1915, since the beginning. She recommended that the Stedman Architectural Collection at the St. Louis Public Library and the Washington University would be much more suitable repositories for these books. So by the mid-century mark, the Richardson Memorial Library had aged into its new location. It had become a research hub for not only staff, but community members, students, and scholars. Library staff, though, felt it was time to modernize the library to reflect its evolving role and to, quote, free the reference room of its heavy Edwardian look, quote. Although the furnishings and casework remained intact, lighting fixture improvements and an updated circulation desk helped revamp the space to be more indicative of the 1960s. Ann Abbott ascends to the head librarian position in 1968. She shepherds the library through the next two decades. It was under her stewardship that a formal museum archives program was established in 1976. Among the first holdings of the new archives were the Fine Arts Department records from the 1904 World's Fair that had been stored for 70 years in a third floor room underneath a layer of coal dust. So while the basement location had worked fine in 1938, by the 1970s, there were increasing concerns over collection care. There was a lack of climate control, more specifically air conditioning, that proved to be particularly difficult for library staff working in a space that had been built as a hallway. So in the mid-1970s, the architectural firm of Hardy, Halsman, and Pfeiffer set to work on designing a new administration service wing known as the South Building for the museum that could address these space concerns. So for about a 5-year period, a lot of staff members were working at a building on Delmar Boulevard. Library staff, though, remained on site in Forest Park throughout those years, which also provided an opportunity for head librarian Ann Avid to be immersed in the construction planning process from start to finish. And she is noted as saying, "I made it my business to get involved in planning the new space." So the year 1979 saw the library move to its third and current location in the new administration building. The process required inventorying and moving 25,000 volumes of books over the course of a summer. Now, anyone who has moved will know that boxes are a necessity and often seem in short supply. Well, in a really great St. Louis moment, Anheuser-Busch donated over 2,000 beer cartons for the library to use for the move. Librarian Ann Avid remarked on the whole process, saying, "What you see here is the result of the work of 8 women working for 2 solid months." And these images depict the labor that went into safely moving 25,000 books. When I started as the archivist here in 2019, I actually encountered a few of those Budweiser boxes stored in the museum archives, and I was initially quite perplexed. Why were they there? My colleagues actually quickly informed me and shared how these boxes documented that 1979 move to the new building and were very much a tangible portion of that. Okay. So once the books were stored safely, workers deconstructed the bookcases just as they had back in 1938. You can note the right-hand photograph shows the markings on each piece of the bookcases to ensure that they were assembled in the correct order. Now, that's the wonderful part of Gilbert's design of the casework, is that he factored in that the bookcases might need to be moved and crafted them with that in mind. Still, the bookcases were at this point over 60 years old and in need of refinishing. A Missouri Arts Council grant provided funding for the refinishing of the walnut bookcases after they were reinstalled in the library's new reading room space. These photographs show the South Building construction site and the new location of the Richardson Memorial Library painted with a deep plum color. Now think back to that basement location and imagine how this space compares. It's a lot more open, it's much larger, it's more inviting, and it's more illuminated. To put it into perspective, the new space was 6,000 square feet, which more than doubled the library's basement footprint, with room for the collection to expand over the next few decades. I think it's fair to say that Ann Avid deserves credit for actively participating in the space conversations and ensuring that the library design worked both for library staff and patrons. On Tuesday, May 6, 1980, the Richardson Memorial Library reopened in the space it still occupies today. Ann Avid, head librarian and champion of the library, is shown here with Cheryl Vogler, the library assistant at the time and later slide curator. Now the furnishings, the casework, and the Richardson bust all anchor the space back to its 1915 location. In this 1993 view of the library's reading room, you can spot the Richardson bust, but you'll notice it looks slightly different. That's because the pedestal base that was created for the lower basement ceilings had to be replaced with a wood base, which was the third pedestal for the bust. So the bust serves as a thread through the chapters of the library's history. The Richardson Memorial Library celebrated 100 years on April 18, 2015, with a birthday party and book-themed activities throughout the museum. What started as a collection of 5,000 volumes has grown into a research facility that boasts 140,000 volumes. Extensive holdings of auction catalogs and pamphlets documenting the history of artists in St. Louis. The Gilbert casebook and furnishings, outside of some necessary reupholstery, still look very much as they did back when they first welcomed readers in 1915. I invite you to visit our website to learn more about the Richardson Memorial Library and what it has to offer over a century later.
Thank you so much, Jenna, both for that tour through the library's history, but even more importantly, for all that you and your colleagues in the library do to support the museum's staff and patrons. The library plays an absolutely critical role, and really every project that SLAM undertakes, but especially curatorial ones, but I feel like you and your colleagues don't get our gratitude enough. So thank you very publicly. So with that, thanks. Let's return to the murals themselves, and really to the year 1914-15. So as Jenna told us, the museum's board commissioned Cass Gilbert to produce designs to transform these three galleries, these spaces, into the library. So Gilbert wrote to the president of our board in February 1914, approximately a year before the library opened. He described the murals in these terms. So he writes, an important feature of this suite of rooms will be the mural decoration. And I call your attention to the fact that $8,000, which is equivalent to about $220,000 in today's money. So $8,000 has been allowed, therefore. It is proposed to place the decorative work in the hands of Mr. Elmer E. Garnsey, who is perhaps the leading artist in this particular sort of work in this country. In short, the memorial room itself is intended to be a work of art and an exhibit of great importance in the museum. So to me, this description from Gilbert raises two related questions. So the first one is, why murals? Why did he think that this was the appropriate type of decoration? And then the second was, who was Elmer Ellsworth Garnsey, the artist selected by Gilbert? So let's tackle the first one first, why murals? In 1914, a cultural phenomenon known as the American Renaissance had been in full swing for about two decades. Beginning in the 1890s, many American artists and architects embraced the idea that the art of the past could provide useful sources for the development of a new, uniquely American art. They adapted a classical artistic vocabulary from the art of ancient Greece and Rome, mediated through that of the Italian Renaissance. This style, in turn, lent authority to new civic buildings and projects, making them look much older and much more permanent than they in fact really were. Our 1904 building has nearly all of the hallmarks of American Renaissance architecture. Sculpture Hall, as I know many of you already know, is inspired by the Baths of Caracalla from 3rd century Rome. And the building as a whole is built in a Beaux-Arts style, named for the famous École des Beaux-Arts in Paris, which instructed artists and architects in the necessity of order, symmetry, and harmony in their work. But I said that our building has nearly all of the hallmarks of this style, because it was lacking one really significant one, and that is architectural murals. The last decade of the 19th century saw a boom in mural painting. The birth of the so-called American mural movement can be dated to these two projects seen on the screen. So on the left, the 1893 Chicago World's Fair, whose buildings were decorated with hundreds of murals, including those by artists such as Mary Cassatt, whose work we see in the photo on the left. And then on the right, the Library of Congress, which was constructed between 1890 and 1897. It's hard to do either project justice in just one image. I mean, I really can't. The sculptor Augustus St. Gaudens described the Chicago World's Fair as, quote, the greatest meeting of artists since the 15th century, so since the Italian Renaissance. And the Library of Congress project employed 19 artists to produce 112 murals to coat what seems like every surface of its grand building. Most major public buildings created between 1890 and 1920, including those temporary structures for world's fairs, which were not intended to last or be permanent, most of these buildings included some type of mural paintings within them. So quite honestly, it's really a bit unusual that Slam's building initially did not when it was constructed for the 1904 World's Fair. And so the answer, I mean, this to me raises the question as to why. Really, I need Jenna's help in digging through the archives to figure out exactly why. But right now, I mean, the two most obvious thoughts as to why our building didn't initially have murals are the obvious ones. So both reasons of time and reasons of money. So 10 years after the initial construction of our building, so in 1914, Cass Gilbert jumped at the chance to correct this omission. So as we just heard, he recommended that Elmer Garnsey be the artist to decorate the new library in the museum. But a few months later, he also brought out to St. Louis the famed muralist Edwin Howland Blashfield, whose most famous painting we're looking at on the right. And so those are the murals in the reading room of the Library of Congress. Gilbert proposed to our board that Blashfield should be commissioned to cover the ceiling of Sculpture Hall with murals. Blashfield estimated that murals, that a project of that scale would take him about 4 years to complete. And so here's a detail at the top of one of Blashfield's Library of Congress murals, along with another mural by him at the lower right that he made for a domestic home. And I include these here just to go through kind of the fun exercise, at least fun to me, of imagining the ceiling of Sculpture Hall covered in murals of either of these styles. Can you imagine that? I mean, it would drastically change what that space felt like and what the experience would be of being in it. So it seems like, quite honestly, the board couldn't imagine that, or that they just got cold feet for reasons, again, of time and money, because no action was taken on this part of the proposal. But as we've been learning, as we've been hearing, that certainly was not the case for the library murals, which after all were being funded by an outside source. So let's turn our attention back to them. And finally, let me introduce the artist at the center of this. So Elmer Ellsworth Garnsey, who came from New Jersey originally and spent his career based on the East Coast, kind of in and around New York City. So as I hope the list on the left demonstrates, Garnsey was kind of like the Kevin Bacon or Forrest Gump of American Renaissance mural projects. That is, he was involved with nearly all of them. And a number of these buildings in that list on the left were designed by Cass Gilbert, meaning that the two men had a long working relationship. In all of these projects, Garnsey specialized in the parts known as the decorative murals. For instance, designs representing the signs of the zodiac, as you could see at the top center here, his Library of Congress, in a Library of Congress mural that he made, the 12 months of the year, the four seasons, a series of paintings of historic ships that you could see at the lower right. So he really specialized in single figure compositions that were surrounded by dynamic patterns, but he didn't specialize so much in large multi-figured compositions that had complex relationships between their figures or their parts. You could really kind of think of him as if this were either a sporting event, he would be a great like supporting player, really good at assists, or the Oscars, right? He'd be up for a supporting actor Oscar, not a main actor Oscar. And he was described by a contemporary critic as, quote, a cooperative painter who somewhat effaced himself in service to his fellow artists. So that's kind of the overview of Garnsey. His murals at SLAM, though, are something slightly different. So while he had taken a backseat role in the past in many other projects, at SLAM, he at last kind of came into his own. He was age 53 when he painted these works, so closer to the end of his career than its beginning. And our murals are among his most ambitious, accomplished works and a rare commission on which he served as the sole designer. So to wrap up my portion of this, let's take an even closer look at a few of the murals. So a draped female figure sits on a throne at the center of each. A sign hangs above each one of their heads reading architecture, sculpture, printing, and painting. And so these figures are allegorical representations of these four branches of art, with each holding a prop relating to her genre. Garnsey, however, was not really interested in these individual characters. In 1915, he wrote to SLAM's director, he wrote a letter that Courtney will talk about more in a sec, but he wrote a letter explaining his new paintings. And in it, he flatly stated, "It is not an attempt at storytelling, nor are the ideas and personifications intended to serve as texts for literary exercises. The figures are merely incidental to the design as a whole and are relatively of no more importance than any other of the rest of the ornament of which they are a part." So what really interested him was the overall design. So the ornate bands of vertical elements alongside each throne, the graceful drape and swirl of the ribbons connecting the elements, and the repetition of forms on each wall, echoing but not replicating each other. Garnsey also explained in that same letter, quote, "The design is my own, and while it is reminiscent of other Italian Renaissance schemes, I know of none that might be called its legitimate ancestor. In other words, I'm looking back to the past for inspiration, but really I'm making it my own." So Garnsey's murals lent the library, the new library, an air of permanence and sophistication in 1915, and they really continue to elevate how visitors experience Gallery 203 today. But I'd imagine that seeing these close-up details have raised all sorts of questions in your minds about the materials used to create the murals, and of course their current condition. So to answer those questions better than I ever could, let me turn the podium over to Courtney.
Thanks to the historical insights shared by Amy and Jenna, we now have a better understanding of how and why the Garnsey murals came to be, plus a little bit more on artist Elmer Garnsey and his accomplishments. Let's refocus on the murals here at SLAM and view them through the lens of their materials and how they were constructed. This will shed light onto why they are receiving a full conservation treatment this summer. I'd like to call attention to that letter Amy referenced earlier in our talk, where Garnsey wrote to the then acting director, Mr. Holland, in 1915. Since early 20th century murals can be comprised of layers and layers of multiple materials, this letter is golden for the museum to have on hand, thanks to the fact that Garnsey outlines not only his design inspiration for the murals, but also how he made them, and in some instances, exactly what materials he used. And he does so with flourish, using descriptive language such as sonorous color and agreeable texture and surface finish to embellish his artistic intent. Garnsey describes his process from the inner wall and works outwards, like building a cake from the bottom pan to the frosting on top. Walls lined with canvas were coated with a typical priming layer of lead white and linseed oil. Garnsey then describes applying low relief pastework, this is termed vestiglia, by using stencils. And while he does not specify the material used, he does explain that the relief work was applied in progressive heights in order to, quote, catch the glint of light falling from above, end quote. He painted everything next in orange red, applied gold to the areas designed as gilded decoration, and then painted the blue backgrounds that we associate with murals today. A complex pattern of glazes, opaque paints, and more glazes followed. He at times uses language that is perhaps a bit curious to our modern ears, such as pickings out to describe the layers, which is fun to hear, but also, along with sometimes just plain omitting what exact materials he was using, all adds to the mystery left for us to unpack. Finally, he arrives to that frosting on the mural cake, to the protective surface coating, which was an unspecified paste which, quote, permits the cleaning of the walls by washing off and repasting when smoke and grime have unduly blacked the painting, end quote. When we imagine this gallery space as pictured here in 1915, the building, along with the surrounding city of St. Louis, was heated with coal, which Jenna alluded to earlier, and this would have indeed made for a much smokier atmosphere. The decision to coat the wall with a protective layer that would have been removed and replaced with some regularity was therefore understandable. And this illustrates how a muralist such as Garnsey would have expected a degree of maintenance to always be involved in the preservation of these murals. In addition, the room, as we have discussed, has evolved as it transitioned from the grand entrance to the Richardson Memorial Library into a highly decorated gallery space. One rather large change occurred in the late 1970s when a window was placed in the north wall and a portion of the corresponding mural was removed in order to allow more light ingress, as well as to open up a lovely vantage point that spans across Arts Hill. In 1977, museum conservator Clements D. Robertson partially conserved the murals. We see him here on scaffolding, aesthetically reintegrating losses on the west wall. Between Garnsey's letter and Robertson's treatment reports, we can start to form an idea of the material makeup of the murals as they are in present day. Here is a schematic, and I do realize that the details are tiny, but hopefully illustrates just how many layers of materials are likely there. From Garnsey's letters, we can reconstruct the strata representing his purported layers up to the protective coating, and then Robertson's restoration materials swing into play, where he partially removed the coating and then built his materials up from there. With this material composition in mind, and when standing in the space today, one can see that the murals, along with Robertson's restorations, as it has been 50 plus odd end years, they are showing some condition concerns. These concerns can vary from dust and grime accumulation, as well as water damage, which can affect the gloss and color saturation of the paint, as seen as the image on the left. We suspect that remnants of leftover paste coating, described in Garnsey's letter, may be leading to similar issues of discoloration seen in the pendentives, that is the color, the corner connections between the wall and the dome area in the center image. In addition, the aging of the materials arranged in their complex layers have succumbed to the stress of environmental vibrations or increased brittleness, resulting in the loss of paint and pastiglia, as seen on the image on the right. Therefore, what better time than these days when museums are focusing inwards and highlighting their collections in new ways to take the opportunity to help address these condition concerns visible in the Garnsey murals today. In 2020, conservation technician Mary Culver and I combined forces with curatorial and library archival departments at SLAM to research the Garnsey murals. Understanding the artist's materials and techniques better prepared our strategies for up-close examination, as we see Mary up on the lift on the left. Cleaning tests. The center image shows the beautiful original light blue sky of the dome, which for decades we've only been interpreting as a gloomy gray. And sample collection. As analysis of small samples we have collected may answer some of those mysteries that Garnsey's letter presents. This summer, from June to August, Mary Culver, whose background is in architectural preservation, and I can honestly say that working with murals is one of my great loves in the field of conservation, will be applying a full conservation treatment to these murals. This includes documentation, research analysis and testing, as well as cleaning, stabilization of any insecure materials, aesthetic reintegration of losses and discoloration, and also applying a long-lasting protective coating. Sorry, Garnsey, but this will not be a starch paste. We will rather use contemporary conservation grade materials. This project also presents a strong educational opportunity, as we will be welcoming two conservation painting graduate students as interns, as well as one volunteer here at SLAM who is specialized in preservation design to participate in various aspects of the project. And as you may notice here in these detailed shots of cleaning tests, this conservation treatment will carry a rewarding impact that will restore the murals to circa their 1915 aesthetic. More close-up views and stories of the conservation in action project are planned. So we invite you all to tune into the various links shown here as we ensure that this bastion of St. Louis Art Museum, Richardson Memorial Library, and Elmer E. Garnsey history endures. Thank you.
Right, and thank you, all three of you. That was fabulous. I have just dropped the link to the Conservation Project website that is a part of SLAM's website. So I hope that people are able to look there. That website will be continuously updated. There will be lots of things added to that as the summer goes along. So be sure to check back there. And so if we have we've got some time for some questions. I actually have a question to start us off. And Amy, if you could maybe move the slides a few back just to see some images of the mural space. I wanted to know, you can see, so yeah, so any of those, the archway, you can see the archway of archways in there. And I'm just wondering if that was designed by Garnsey or if that's a much more architectural, element. Our archways in the museum don't look like that anywhere else. So just wondering if you knew anything about that. Anybody?
I'm happy to chime in here and say that we do think that these were treated differently, obviously within the building, but then within the space. And we think that Cass Gilbert actually had a heavy hand in the decoration design of these as well. We don't think that Garnsey had directly as much influence in those decorations, and they have been restored and conserved differently than the murals in the dome and the pendentives as well, which is another clue that these spaces were comprised and designed a little differently. And we know that they have been restored in the 70s and the 90s, because when you do get up on a lift and you get up in the bird's eye view of that dome there, you can read little inscriptions saying so-and-so is here and restored in this year. So it's wonderful little vestiges of their work in the past, and they're in good condition. So we actually will be leaving most of those be.
Great, okay, thank you. Okay, let me look at some questions here. A few people are wondering how long the restoration effort is expected to take.
I can again chime in. it is a work in progress. It always kind of goes at a different pace depending on what we encounter, but we do really anticipate that things will cooperate to a certain degree. The materials, as you hopefully was illustrated, we've put a lot of planning and research into this. So we do think that active conservation will span from really get going in June and then extend to August. So we've got about 3 solid months of pretty consistent work with about 3 to 4 people consistently working on it. So it completely depends always on and what you encounter and the scope and the degree of preservation and condition that we encounter things. But these aren't, we can see little details of condition issues, but all in all, they need some cleaning, they need some TLC, but they're going to cooperate. So 3 months for this one.
Yeah, great. And actually, this is for you as well. So someone is asking if visitors will be able to see the work take place. So I kind of know the answer to that, but I'm going to turn that over to you.
Sure. We have taken pains to try to give as much vantage points to the work while keeping everyone safe, because it is going to be an active space with construction and scaffolding. And so you will be able to kind of look and see in opposing walls through gallery spaces, since it is a gallery that opens up to 3 different galleries. And then we also are going to be having some programming from the scaffolding as far as videotapes and pictures and images. And so time-lapse camera, for instance, that we're hoping to put up there. So people will be able to get multiple vantage points as it's going on. But we do ask visitors to kind of keep their distance as well and look from afar if they can. We want people to enjoy the progress.
Let's see. Okay. Well, Courtney, all the questions so far are for you, so I'm going to just keep asking. someone is asking, what will be the greatest challenge in treating the murals? Materials in painting or cleaning? And you already mentioned that you are working up pretty high, so there is an element of safety there as well.
It's an interesting question. I don't necessarily know that there will be a more challenging or more, you know, kind of attention demanding step than another. Cleaning is always the most time dedicated step, 9 times out of 10. And we're really lucky that the walls are stable, so we don't have to get in there and stabilize the plaster to a extreme degree. That would be the extreme endeavor here. So we're really lucky with that. So I do think that finding the correct cocktail of materials to clean, and we do take pains to work with, as I mentioned, conservation grade materials, but also non-toxic materials as much as we can, certainly during museum open hours to really ethically and carefully treat these murals in the cleaning process. And that's kind of the maybe perhaps the most calculated, sophisticated and kind of time enduring step that takes. Plus there's a lot of wall to cover. So the cleaning will be the more intensive step.
Yeah. Okay, so I'm not sure if you or Jenna might be able to answer this. Someone wanted to know, was smoking ever permitted in the museum, specifically in this gallery? my guess would be yes, because I feel like smoking was okay everywhere, but I don't know if there's any evidence of that.
Yes, we have in the historic photographs in the museum archives, we have images of people, not many, but smoking in those areas. And it wasn't just specifically the Gallery 203, it was others as well. And it kind of reflected other changes at other museums throughout the US. And so as smoking policies came into impact, it impacted this museum as well. And so that was something that eventually went away.
Yeah, obviously, yeah. Great, thank you. All right, let's see. Courtney, back to you. Is there a simple explanation of how the conservators determine what colors are closest to the originals?
There's multiple ways we can figure that out and approximate as best as we can, and we do our best. So the samples that I briefly mentioned earlier, these are very tiny samples that we collect. Those will we embed in resin and then put under a microscope so we get a cross section. And so then we have the layering and the strata there. And you can get a sense of the colors because even if a paint has oxidized at the surface or aged or discolored, there's grime on top, we can get down beneath that layer in that cross section and see, you know, kind of approximation of the true hue. Of course, too, cleaning helps too, like that blue, the baby blue of the dome, once you get up there and if you've cleaned some grime or a paste that's never been taken off, that really uncovers, you know, a gem of the true hue as well. So it's a good question that, you know, we're always kind of trying to approximate as close as we can. There's a couple of other sophisticated analytical tools that we could bring in to kind of analyze what colors and pigments are present. We might get up in there with a XRF machine, which is a device that allows us to detect what pigments might be likely present, and we can kind of ascertain what hues he would have used and what pigments, but it is kind of an approximation game. So always kind of, because he was very attentive to glazes as well and toning. He talks a lot about that as well. So we want to be sensitive to, he's saying he's using this color, but then if he's putting something on top intentionally to tone it down, we have to be attentive to what the desired effect was. So that's mm-hmm. where those cross sections are really helpful.
Yeah. Let's see. This is about the library. So Jenna, is the library open to visitors and is an appointment needed?
We currently are not open to the public, although normally during non-pandemic times, we are open to the public during Tuesdays through Fridays. Stay tuned for updates. And if you go to our website, you can find out more information. And when we do reopen the reading room, we will welcome visitors back into the space. We are doing reference requests virtually. So that's always an option as well. If you want to visit our website, there's contact information on there. So you can call us with any questions you have.
Awesome. All right. So last question. How long typically does a restoration effort last before the murals must be restored again?
very, very much depends on the condition and what's going on and why they're being restored. So if they're being restored by natural aging processes, this is determined by the quality of the materials used, how stable the materials are. Then you've got environmental factors that are coming in. Was there ever any moisture damage? You know, was there a flood, a leak? And then how much natural light was pouring in at a given time? You know, do you have light damage? So was there an earthquake? We are in a seismic, I believe, rift here in mm-hmm. St. Louis. So so it really, really depends. But I can't quite pinpoint closer to that as far as how you gauge depending on the materials and the objects. So like I said, this effort for the amount of people that we have working on it will take about 3 months for a room this size, but it's got, you know, anywhere from 2 weeks if it's a very light, you know, quick dry cleaning to then 3, 4, 5 years depending on what's going on.
All right. Well, thanks to all of you. I really appreciate it. And I really look forward to seeing this finished product. And I think we will have more updates as the summer progresses. So I encourage everyone to be on the lookout for that. And thanks to everyone who joined us today. If you'd like, register to join me on Thursday, June 3rd, to hear curator Simon Kelly speak about the artist Theodore Rousseau, who played an important role in creating the modern art market in 19th century France. Thank you all and have a great day.